to the final episode of the Valkyrie Ensemble Suffragette Summer. I'm Karen Hunt, our General and Artistic Director. We've spent this series learning about and celebrating the heroines of the suffrage movement and how they fought for the rights of marginalized groups. Today, we're going to talk about allyship. Progress towards equality has only come when those with power and influence have shared that power and influence for the benefit of those without. My fellow Valkyries and I will be returning to the featured subjects of our earlier episodes and sharing resources so that you can also learn how to be a supportive and effective ally. The borderlands concept is a great way of understanding how while we may all come from different backgrounds of privilege and prejudice, we are all subject to the harms of a system built on structural bias, and that we also all have the agency to support those who are different from us. Borderlands, or La Frontera, is a book by Gloria Anzaldúa, a queer Chicano cultural theorist, poet, and teacher. In her book, Anzaldúa talks about the border as both a physical and a psychological place, and uses the metaphor of the border to describe a power analysis of the U.S. and its dominant cultural institutions. It asks, who is presumed to be good, normal, standard, moral, or civilized? What values and ways of thinking and doing are presumed to be desirable, moral, and superior? The answers to these questions will be different for each person that answers them, but we can identify what is the dominant cultural center of a given place, such as the United States. There is constant movement between the center and the borderlands, either in order to gain more power and resources from the center, or in order to save or exploit the borderlands. We all have parts of our identities that align with both the center and the borderlands, but it is often not up to us whether or not we are welcomed or rejected by the dominant cultural center because of our given identities.
They judge me before they even know me. That's why I'm better off alone.
In order to truly be an ally and help others, we must work to change or dismantle these unjust systems, rather than just saving people within it. A great example of this theory as a means of power analysis can be found at the link below from Arts Alliance Illinois' webinar on arts and culture as part of the solution, an intro to systemic racism. I highly recommend watching the whole video, and the link can be found in the description below. In my episode on the shared struggle for suffrage, we learned about how suffrage was denied largely on the basis of race, in addition to gender and wealth. To be an anti-racist ally, it is important to know the definition of racism does not end at hate. Racism is the combination of racial prejudice and the misuse of power by systems and institutions. In relations to the borderlands concept, in the United States, whiteness is an identity of the center, and marginalized groups and people of color often serve as the foils used to justify the current system of power. As we learned in the first episode of this series, even while Black Americans and American women were fighting for the same rights to equality and suffrage, they were at times adversarial. To this day, there is conflict and criticism of what is called white feminism, which seeks gender equality but excludes the differences of power and privilege granted to white women compared to women of color. Kimberly Crenshaw, an American law professor and civil rights advocate, offers another view, one of intersectional feminism, a term she coined in 1989 and describes as a prism for seeing the way in which various forms of inequality operate together and exacerbate each other. Intersectional feminism centers the voice of those experiencing overlapping, concurrent forms of oppression in order to understand the depths of the inequalities and the relationships among them in any given context. More information about intersectional feminism can be found at unwomen.org and in Hood Feminism by Mickey Kendall. An example of separatist versus inclusive feminism was the split of the women's suffrage movement following the introduction and passage of the 15th Amendment, which gave Black men the right to vote, but not women. Elizabeth Cady Stanton and Susan B. Anthony formed the National Woman Suffrage Association, which advocated that black men should not get the vote before white women. Side-eye, Susan. This time, it's my turn to give you the side-eye. In contrast, the newly formed American Woman Suffrage Association pushed for both black and women's suffrage on a state-by-state basis, and was led by Lucy Stone and Julia Ward Howe. While the two organizations eventually reunited, it is a reminder that even when people experience similar discrimination based on something such as gender, they can still be divided and prejudiced against their compatriots based on their differences of race, identity, and class. The gendered struggles of white women are not the same as those of black, Latino, Native American, or any other woman of a racial minority in the United States. Allyship is productive when we are not just bonded by our shared struggles, but also, and perhaps even more importantly, by the recognition of and advocacy for the different challenges we face. Where privilege is held, it should be used to lift those without. And progress is never true progress if it is at the expense or sacrifice of someone else. Education is one of the best tools we have, and fortunately, there are some incredible teachers out there. Another resource that has been a huge learning tool for me is the book Me and White Supremacy by Layla F. Saad, which is available in print, ebook, and audiobook format. If you're more of a podcast or Instagram user, you can see my recommendations in the description of this video. Allyship can be difficult to navigate, and you will definitely make mistakes along the way. First and foremost, though, a true ally listens to understand. Compare this to predatory listening, where the intent is not to understand, but to listen in order to poke holes in an argument or to be simultaneously formulating your rebuttal. To try and help without understanding the experiences and needs of a marginalized group is ignorant at best and extremely damaging at its worst. The best thing to remember are to always strive to keep learning, listening, and standing up against injustice. That was enough from me. So it is with great pride that I pass you along to our Director of Social Justice and Programming, Julia Rom.
Thanks, Karen. So the very nature of the LGBTQ community is intersectional in the sense that each of these letters, LGBT and Q, represent a specific identity. It could be argued that without the allyship of all of these marginalized groups working together for a common cause, the movement would not have made it as far as it has. Given this, there has never just been one way to be an ally to the LGBTQ community. But I think the most important thing is to simply have an open mind, to be open to listening to another person's experience. Basic human qualities of imagination. Putting yourself in another person's shoes, that's the first step. But I mean, the truth is, we all need to be allies to each other because we're all individuals and we all face unique challenges. If we want others to care about our own experience and our own struggles, then we have to be willing to extend that grace to the rest of the population. So if you're straight and or cisgendered and you want to be an ally to the LGBTQ community, there are plenty of things you can do. So starting off, you can do your research and vote for candidates who actually are committed to making a positive difference for these communities. And that doesn't mean looking at sources that are not reputable, like, QAnon? No.
Sashay away.
You can also make your allyship obvious. If there's one thing that I wished for as a questioning baby lesbian in high school, it's that, okay, yes, that is a photo of me with a mohawk sophomore year. Just enjoy that while it lasts. Anyway, if even one of my high school teachers that had a rainbow pin or some kind of little sign in their office that made it clear that they were an ally to me, it would have made things so much easier and I would have felt so much less alone back then. So little things like that actually make a really huge difference. Sometimes when you're struggling to come out of the closet, all you need to see is that there's someone by your side who's not gonna judge you and who will be there to defend you if things get rough.
Go ahead. I support you.
Thirdly, you can speak up when you see transphobic or homophobic behavior. We don't need to be nags, but we can simply say something if we witness this in our day-to-day life. We can say politely that this is unacceptable or hurtful. It's pretty simple. Fourthly, if you want to get more involved, you can join your LGBTQ community center near you, or a PFLAG, or some kind of organization that is fighting for justice for this community. And, you know, you don't really need to single-handedly save the world. None of us can do that. But you can look deeply within your heart and see what it is that you can do, what kind of contribution you can make, if that is something that is calling to you. Something tells me that if you're watching this video right now, you are well on your way. And finally, just remember that allyship is never just toward one group. We are all interconnected. And, you know, personally, I'm always trying to think how I, as a white woman, can be more of an ally to Black, Brown, Indigenous communities, as well as LGBT communities, and being a good feminist and all of this stuff. It's all connected. So we can't just think of one group as existing within some kind of vacuum. That's just not how the world is. It's a constant learning process, but that's life. That is what we're doing every day, hopefully. I mean, if we're not learning, then that'd be kind of depressing. We all belong to each other. And so let's all keep learning, acting in solidarity, and growing together. And with that, I pass the hat off to my lovely friend, Emily, who will be talking a bit more about some male allies in the fight for the women's right to vote in New Zealand.
Hello, everyone. So as we know, in 1893, for the third time, the women's suffrage bill was facing its final hurdle with New Zealand's Legislative Council. It looked like a third defeat was likely, but they ended up getting 18 votes out of a total of 20. The women's franchise petitioned 32,000 signatures, which definitely helped their efforts to finally being heard.
And welcome to my cable show, Shut Up and Listen.
They had lobbied men, and crucially, the women's movement had several key male supporters. Parliament was divided, and previous attempts to enfranchise women, or at least female ratepayers, had only been narrowly defeated. Many leading politicians were supportive of women's suffrage, such as Robert Stout and John Balance, although others such as Richard Seddon, who had become premier in 1893, were as hostile as a jump scare Bilbo Baggins. Fortunately, Seddon's meddling backfired, for two of the councillors had changed their votes to embarrass the premier, and the electoral bill was passed.
Surprise, mother...
Robert Stout in 1879 had introduced an electoral bill which allowed female ratepayers to be eligible to vote and to stand for parliament. I mean, look at this guy. I like him already. I mean, look at that hat. I want that hat. I wonder where can I get that hat? I like your hat. He was largely responsible for the Married Women's Property Act in 1884, which declared a married woman capable of acquiring, holding, and disposing of any property in her own right. So he also later worked in a close association with his wife, Anna, to limit the testamentary freedom of husbands so that property could not be willed away from the wives. I mean, they were the petty police, and your petty application has been denied. Despite having friends in the alcohol industry, John Balance still assisted the women's right movement by voting in their favor. Speaking the House in 1890, he declared, "I believe in the absolute equality of the sexes, and I think that they should be in the enjoyment of equal privileges in political matters." I mean, political matters is a start. Although Balance sought to delay the implementation of women's voting rights until after the 1893 election, claiming that women were politically uneducated and that their vote likely wouldn't help the liberals. His support may have been to advance his own political pursuits, but he may have encountered the wimp penalty, where men who are seen as more collaborative and power-sharing are evaluated by both men and women as less competent, and not incidentally, less masculine. Egalitarian men can feel a backlash of the stigma by association, perceived as being similar to women by advocating for them. And these repercussions can still plague our allies of feminism today. These men listen to the suffragettes, and they use their power to help further their cause to victory. And if you want to get political, gender equality is increasingly framed as being central to the realization of both modernization and economic efficiency, and its achievement is presented as a key to good governance. And as a result, the New Zealand government has been a world leader in implementing institutional mechanisms to promote the advancement of women and gender equality. So how you can promote global allyship today can start with the He For She campaign. He For She is a social movement that provides a systemic approach and targeted platform for men and boys to become agents of change for gender equality. It launched at the United Nations in 2014 by UN Secretary General Ban Ki-moon and UN Women Global Goodwill Ambassador Emma Watson. Millions of men from around the world, including heads of state, CEOs, and global luminaries, have committed to gender equality. On the He For She website, a geolocating map records the global engagement of the movement through counting the number of men and women around the world who have taken the pledge for the initiative, registering over 2.1 million commitments worldwide. So you can make the pledge by clicking the link below. We define male allies as members of an advantage group committed to building relationships with women, expressing as little sexism in their own behavior as possible, and understanding the social privilege conferred by their gender, and demonstrating active efforts to address gender inequities at work and in society. They are catalysts for change. The hard part is for you to take informed action. Use your experience in women's initiatives to learn how you can best become a public ally for social justice around gender. The world is a big place, and there's a great deal of injustice out there, but start at home. When the time comes, this may require you to upset the status quo within your own culture. Bringing us back to the beginning and even back home, I'll pass it along to Maddie, who will talk about more great male allies during the American enfranchisement movement.
Since the beginning of U.S. history, there have been several suffragettes pioneering for the women's movement, many of them men, including Frederick Douglass and Thaddeus W. Smith. Frederick Douglass was an African-American escaped slave, writer, abolitionist, and diplomat who lived before and during the Civil War. He supported Elizabeth Cady Stanton's decision to read the Declaration of Sentiments at the Seneca Falls Convention, stating, "All that distinguishes man as an intelligent and accountable being is equally true of women. And if that government is only just which governs by the free consent of the governed, there can be no reason in the world for denying women the exercise of the elective franchise or a hand in making and administering the laws of the land. Our doctrine is, right is of no sex." Tennessee native Thaddeus W. Smith was fiercely dedicated to help women get the right to vote. He is known for showing up to vote in favor of women's suffrage, having just broken his arm. He powered through the pain and stayed until the very end of the voting process in hopes of persuading other men to vote in favor of the women's right to vote. All of these incredible allies that we've discussed today, as well as the ones that we've discussed in previous episodes, all helped women get the right to vote in the United States. Thanks to the brave men who went against the grain of popular opinion, the warrior women who continue to keep up the fight, as well as all people in their walks of life who helped contribute to the movement, women can now freely vote. To quote British author Deborah Coughlin, "Women need men to share in order for there to be a long-term change. We need them to willingly share power, money, and space with us. It's a hard sell, which is why we need to do the same. White women need to share with women of color. Cis women need to share with trans women. Third generation immigrants need to share with first generation. It doesn't mean each group can have its own protection and spaces, but we need to challenge ourselves and others to act in solidarity with those who are fighting for equality." Thank you so much for tuning into our series of Suffragette Summer, a celebration honoring the 100th anniversary of the women's right to vote in the United States. We cannot believe that it is over, but have no fear. We will be back next year. We hope You and your loved ones continue to stay safe during this time of uncertainty, and please remember to vote in this November's election in honor of this century-old right that the suffragettes gave to us.